One, we got an introduction to what forwards and futures were. We understood how the payoff will happen at maturity for all of these instruments. The focus now would be to solve various examples and understand the valuation of forward markets and contracts. Valuation at expiration, valuation after some time has passed, that is valuing off the market contracts. So we'll do various examples and try to understand these concepts. Please note, the curriculum mentions various formulae that we have proved in the previous session. That is, how to value the long position a few days after initiation, the value of the long position at initiation. Please remember, the value of the forward or the fair forward price at initiation would be given as the spot price into 1 plus the risk-free rate to the power t. For FRM students, the curriculum generally uses continuous compounding and even in some places of CFA. So using if RF is a continuously compounded rate, the concept remains the same. The forward or the fair forward price would become s e raised to the power rt. Please remember, in all formulae as we have proved, if the asset pays a discrete dividend of d, then all formulae that we derived, we would replace s by s minus the present value of the dividend. The forward price was earlier s into 1 plus r to the power t. The fair forward price now would be s minus the present value of the dividend, that is the value of the dividend today, into 1 plus RF to the power T, where RF is the risk-free rate and T is the time to maturity of the forward contract. If the asset pays a continuously compounded dividend R star, then the formula would become S e to the power RT instead of, so we still subtract the present value of the dividend, but if the dividend is not given a discrete dividend, rather, it is given a continuously compounded dividend of r star, then this would become e to the power r minus r star into t. This is probably the only formula that you need to remember for solving any question on forwards and futures. Other formulae are also mentioned. However, we'll soon see that we don't need to know anything else for solving any question on forwards and futures. The fair forward price is S into 1 plus RF to the power T. If it's a dividend paying asset, then it would be S minus the present value of dividend into 1 plus RF to the power T, as we proved in the previous session. The value of the long position at any point can be derived using the formulas as shown. Please note that the formulae are mentioned in the curriculum, hence I'm showing you the formula, but as we'll solve many questions using all these concepts, it is advised that you don't remember these formulae and you solve the concepts right from the basics, as we will see. The long counterparty is obligated to purchase the asset at the predetermined price. The short counterparty is obligated to sell the asset at the predetermined price. Using that and the derivation of the first formula, we'd be able to derive all these formulas as needed. Please note, in the case of currency forwards and examples of those we will do, the domestic risk-free rate can be thought of as RF and the foreign risk-free rate can be thought of as the continuously compounded dividend yield. So the forward rate would be given as the spot price into 1 plus the domestic rate upon 1 plus the foreign rate raised to the power t. If it's a continuously compounded forward or a continuously compounded rate is given, then it would simply be f would be s e raised to the power r domestic minus r foreign into t. We understand all concepts with more examples. So consider a 6-month forward contract on a zero coupon bond with a face value of $10,000 that is currently quoted at $6,000. and assume a risk-free annual interest rate of 8%. Determine the price of the forward contract under the no arbitrage principle. So no arbitrage price we have derived is given as S into 1 plus R to the power T for non-dividend paying assets. Is a zero coupon bond income producing? Or does it pay any coupon or dividend in the middle? No. So this will be valued using the first formula. So the spot price is given to be $6,000. The risk-free rate is given to be 8%. And the time to maturity is 6 months, that is 6 by 12, which can be calculated. For FRM students, the concept remains the same. And even for CFA, if continuous compounding is given, it would be same. Only thing is it would be e to the power 0.08 into 6 by 12. So let's first calculate 1.08 y to the power x 0.5 and multiply it with 6000, which will give us the fair forward price as 6235.38. In our 6 months zero coupon bond contract example, we determined the no arbitrage forward price was so much. Suppose that 2 months after the spot price on the zero coupon bond is 6,500 and the risk-free rate is still 8%, calculate the value of the long and short positions in the forward contract. Remember, in any derivative contract, it is a zero-sum game. So the value of the long plus the value to the short is equal to zero, or value to one counterparty will exactly and equally be the opposite of the value to the other counterpart. So the question says is that at t equal to zero, let's assume we longed this contract. That is, we would purchase this asset and we would have to pay 62535.383 at the end of t equal to 6. 6 months later, this is a right as well as an obligation. 2 months have now passed. The price that was 6,000 here has now become 6,500. Does our obligation still remain to buy at 6235.8383? Yes, that obligation will remain till t equal to 6. Now, at t equal to 2, let's say that we want to exit this contract. We longed this zero coupon bond. The long counterparty must have expected that the price is going to go up, so that when he purchases this asset by paying so much, he would in turn be able to sell it at a higher price. As it looks like, his view appears to be going right, because the asset has already in 2 months moved up to 6,500. The long probably now thinks that the move has happened. I expected a 10% about move, which has already happened. So I don't want to be long this contract anymore. I want to lock in my profit right here. Or I want to capture this value of 6,500. Please remember, to exit any derivative contract, you need only take an offsetting position in a corresponding maturity contract. So if you are long the asset 4 months forward, please note this contract is no longer a 6 month contract. It is now only a 4 month contract. So I need to short a position or short a forward 4 months now. So I'm already long the first forward. Let's call it F1. This is the original price I entered into. And let's say I now short F2. That is, I am entering into an agreement here to sell this asset for a predetermined price of F2. F2 again will be given by the no arbitrage principle as 6500 into 1 plus 0.08 to the power 4 by 12. Or we can derive F2 as 1.08. We store this in the memory register 1. 4 divided by 12. We'll store it in the memory register 2. Recall 1. Y to the power x, recall 2, and multiply it with 6500. This will give us the value of F2. We'll store it now in the memory register 1 again. So F2 comes out to be $6,668.9. So what I'm now entering into is a contract to sell this asset and receive $6,668.9. As soon as I short this second contract, there is no risk in my position. That is, the asset can now go to 5,000. It can even go to 10,000. My position is not impacted because I have locked in my purchase price also, and I have locked in my purchase price and I've locked in my selling price also. So come what may, at t equal to 6, I will buy this asset by paying 6235.38, the contract I had already entered, and I will sell this asset for receiving $6,668.9. That is, at maturity, my payoff is fixed at F2 minus F1. The value of the contract today, however, will be the present value of these payments. To compute the present value, I need only discount it back by 1 plus 0.08 to the power 4 by 12. This is the formula that we had shown earlier, that will be F2 minus F1 upon 1 plus RF to the power T, where T is the remaining time to maturity. Now again, you don't need to remember these formulae. You could solve it just like the way we did from simple logic and applying the concept that you need to take an offsetting position to exit any derivative contract. So let's solve and calculate the answer. So we already have 668.9, subtract 6235.38, store it in the memory register 2. Let's compute 4 divided by 12 again, store it in the memory register 3, 1.08 y to the power x, recall 3, will give us 1.08 to the power 4 by 12, store it in the memory register 4, recall 2 divided by recall 4 will give us the value of the contract as 422.546. So today itself, we can lock in a value of approximately $422.54 by entering into this contract. That is, if we were to sell our position to somebody else, this is the amount we would charge, because this is how much we are in the money. The short counterparty would have a negative position of the same amount. The short is losing to the same extent because he would be selling for 6235.8383, whereas he would be buying at 6668.9. So if the short wanted to do a stop loss, if the short thought that this 6500 is becoming 7000, because of some positive news, then he can lock in a loss of 422.54 today and exit his position. We'll do many more examples of this type, just so that we are confident of the calculations and the concept. Similarly, calculate the no arbitrage forward price for a 100-day forward on a stock that is currently priced at $50. And is expected to pay a dividend of $0.5 in 20 days, another $0.5 in 80 days, and $0.7 in 160 days, the annual yield curve or the annual interest rate is 6% and the yield curve is flat. That is for all maturities, you can discount by 6%. So let's first depict a timeline of all that is happening in this question. We are asked to compute the no arbitrage forward on a 100-day forward. The current price or the current spot price is $50. We'll call that t equal to 0. First dividend is coming in 20 days. That is at t equal to 20. We are getting $0.5. At t equal to 80, we are getting $0.7. T equal to 100 is where we have to price this forward. And at T equal to 160, we're getting another $0.7. Apologies, another $0.5 at T equal to 80. Now please note that the spot price on or the forward price on dividend paying assets is a spot price minus the present value of all dividend payments into 1 plus RF to the power T. The spot price is given to be $5. The first dividend payment is coming 20 days away. So the present value of that will be 0.5 upon 1 plus 0.06 to the power 20 divided by 365. The second dividend payment is coming 80 days away. Value again would be 0.5 upon 1 plus 0.06 to the power 80 divided by 365. Please note, the dividends coming after the investment horizon or the forward horizon will not matter. So this is where we will apply the 1 plus RF to the power T. So into 1 plus 0.06 to the power 100 divided by 365. This is how we can calculate the forward price for dividend paying asset. The forward contract is a right as well as an obligation to long the asset or to short the asset at a fixed price at a pre-decided date. So we would long this asset at so much price. Please note, if we buy in the forward, we miss out on the dividends, and hence we are willing to pay a lower price. If the short counterparty sells in the forward, he gains on these dividends. Had he sold in the spot, he would have gotten 50, but he wouldn't have gotten these dividends. So please watch the proof of this in the previous video. And please note that the dividends coming after t equal to 100 won't matter. Again, for FRM students, you would generally discount 0.5 e raised to power minus RT. So e raised to power minus 0.06 into 20 by 365 is what you would do. The concept remains exactly the same. If nothing is mentioned, the CFA students should generally assume annual compounding. The FRM students should assume continuous compounding. So please verify that this would come out to be $49.7965. After 50 days, the value of the stock in the previous example is $55. Calculate the value of the equity forward contract on the stock to the long position, assuming the risk-free rate is still 6% and the yield curve is flat. So, in the same example, we entered the contract at t equal to 0. Again, the question is for the long position. So we would pay $49.79 and long this asset at t equal to 100. We are asked to calculate the value at t equal to 50. At t equal to 50, again, our call seems to be going right. The stock has gone up from 50 to 55. One dividend that was supposed to be coming at t equal to 20 of $0.5 must already have come. And another dividend that was originally coming at t equal to 80 will still be coming now 30 days away of another $0.5. That third dividend still doesn't matter. So by the same logic, we have agreed to long this contract for a price of F1. To square off our position, we only need to short an offsetting contract or take a short position in an offsetting contract. So we will short the contract, or we will agree that at t equal to 100, we will sell this asset to receive a price of F2, which will now be valued based on today's spot price and today's rate of interest. It will be 52 minus 0.5 divided by 1 plus 0.06 to the power 30 divided by 365, because it's only 30 days away this dividend now, whole multiplied by 1 plus r to the power t, that is whole multiplied by 1 plus 0.06 to the power 50 divided by 365. This will be the value of F2. So let's solve. We'll first compute 30 divided by 365. Store it in the memory register 1. 1.06 y to the power x, recall 1. We'll store it again in the memory register 1. 0.5 divided by recall 1 will give us the present value of the first dividend, minus 55. We'll do a plus minus and we'll store it in the memory register 2. So this is the first term. We'll now compute 50 divided by 365. Store it in memory register 3, 1.06. First, y to the power x, recall 3, and multiply it with recall 2, where we had stored the first term, will give us the final answer as 54.939, approximately $54.94. So, we will long the asset by paying 49.79. That is an agreement we had already entered at t equal to 0. At t equal to 50, we can enter an agreement to short the asset at today's no arbitrage price. Today's no arbitrage price is 54.94. As soon as I short the second contract, I have agreed to buy this asset at a fixed price and sell this asset at a fixed price. So my payoff at t equal to 100, that is F2 minus F1, or 54.94 minus 49.79, is fixed. Discounting it back to t equal to 50, that is discounting it back by 50 days, or 1 plus r to the power 50 by 365, will give us the answer, or give us the value at t equal to 50. So let's first calculate 50 divided by 365. Store it in the memory register 1. 1.06. And y to the power x, recall 1, and we'll again store it in the memory just a 1. We'll then do 54.94 minus 49.79 divided by recall 1 will give us the answer as approximately $5.11. The value of the contract to the long is again positive, the tune of around $5.11, as we can imagine, because the stock price has moved up. The value to the short is exactly equally opposite. Please verify the calculation. Again, please note, you don't need to use all these formulae that are mentioned in the book. You can solve right from the basics and get the correct answer. With practice, everything will become really fast. So make sure you practice a lot of questions so that it becomes more fluent. The value of the Dow Jones index is 2500. The continuously compounded risk-free rate is 6%, and the continuous dividend yield is 3%. Calculate the no arbitrage price of a 150-day forward contract on the index. Please note, now the question categorically mentions continuous compounding, so we have no option. Compounding doesn't make a difference to the concept. You can have annual, quarterly, semi-annual, or continuous. So the forward price in the case of continuous compounding would be S e to the power RF into T if the stock was a non-dividend paying stock. It's the same as S into 1 plus RF to the power T. The stock is a dividend paying stock, it would be S e to the power RF minus R star into T. This is similar as S minus present value of a dividend if it was a discrete dividend into 1 plus RF to the power T. S is given to be 2500, E to the power RF is given as 0.06 minus 0.03 into 150 by 365. Which we can calculate, 150 divided by 365 into 0.03, we'll raise it to the power E, so second and ln, and multiply it with 2500, which comes out to be 2531.01. After 90 days in the same contract, the value of the index in the previous example has now gone down to 2000 from 2500. Calculate the value of the long position assuming the risk-free rate is 6% and the continuously compounded dividend yield is 3%. So it was a 150-day contract or a 150-day forward. Once again, first depict the timeline and understand what's happening. At T equal to 0, we entered the contract for delivery at T equal to 150. We are today at T equal to 90. That is, 90 days have passed. So it's now a 60-day contract, wherein again, we are longing the asset. That's the contract we've entered into, and we'll be paying an amount equal to 2531. So this is what we have already entered into. At T equal to 90, to offset this position, I just need to short the asset, and that shorting will happen at today's no arbitrage price. Today's no arbitrage price would be given as 2000, please note now it will not be based on 2500, into e raised to the power 0.06 minus 0.03 into 60 by 365. And again, the present value will be calculated as F2 minus F1. This is the gain that I can lock in, sell at F2, buy at F1, and the value today, that is at T equal to 90, will be the present value of this. So again, divided by e raised to power RT will be the present value. So let's first calculate F2, 0.03 into 60 divided by 365, press second and press ln, and multiply it with 2000, that is 2010.19. So the price that he can lock in for selling today is 2010.19, whereas he has already purchased to buy it for 2531. We can see as the index has fallen from 2500 to 2000, the long counterparty will lose. If he's expecting the index to fall further, he can do a stop loss today. That is, he can lock in this loss by shorting this second forward. So let's again compute the value to the long counterparty. It will now be 2010.19 minus 2531. We'll store it in the memory just over 1 and we'll compute e raised to power rt, r is 0.06 multiplied by 60 divided by 365 and press second ln. Stored as a memory register 2, recall 1 divided by recall 2, it gives us the answer as 515.7 minus. So today itself I can lock in a negative value of 515.7, or that is the amount of loss that I am in. Calculate the price of a 300-day forward contract on a 9% US Treasury bond with a spot price of 1035, including accrued interest. So this is the dirty price. This is the actual price that we will get paid, or we will have to pay if we purchase this bond, that has just paid a coupon and will make another coupon payment in 220 days. So we are at t equal to 0, and the next coupon payment is expected at t equal to 220, and we are valuing a forward contract for t equal to 300. So we'll again apply the same concept. The spot price, or rather the forward price, will be equal to spot price minus the present value of dividend into 1 plus r to the power t. The spot price of the bond is 1035. The dividend or the coupon is coming at the rate of 9% 220 days later. Please note, it's a US Treasury bond. So by default, you will assume semi-annual compounding and semi-annual coupon payment. So if it's a 9% bond, then the coupon payment would be 9% divided by 2 into $1,000. That will come out to be $45. Please note, this 220 days is not possible. The coupon would latest come in 180 days. So never mind this mistake in the question. Just understand the concept. So $45, for now we will assume, comes at t equal to 220, doesn't make a difference to the concept. And we are valuing this at t equal to 300. So 1035 minus 45 divided by 1 plus 0.09, or rather 0.08, because 8% is the risk-free rate, to the power 220 divided by 365, whole multiplied by 1 plus 0.08 into 300 divided by 365. Please verify, this calculation would come out to be 1056.8191. After 200 days, the value of the bond in the previous example is 1105. So from 1035, the value has become 1105. Calculate the value of the forward contract on the bond to the long position, assuming the risk-free rate is 8%. So again, conceptually, whether it's a bond or a stock, nothing in the concept changes. So we were originally at t equal to 0 on a 300-day forward. We are now at t equal to 200. The coupon was expected at t equal to 220, so now it is only 20 days away. The spot price has now become 1105, and we had already longed a position to purchase this asset. That is, we will pay 1056.8191 and purchase this bond. We can today enter into a 100-month or 100-day forward to short this bond and receive a value equal to F2. where F2 will be given as 1105 minus $45 again, that is coming as dividend upon 1 plus 0.08 to the power 20 by 365 whole multiplied by 1 plus 0.08 to the power 100 by 365. The value to the long counterparty now would be F2 minus F1 upon 1 plus R to the power 100 by 365. That is the present value today. So please verify with the same logic. And the answer, the difference will come out to be $25.42. Please don't worry about these formulae that are mentioned. You don't need any of the formula. We've solved the last 8 questions in exactly the same manner by taking an offsetting position and calculating the certain payoff that we will get and discounting back that certain payoff to the current time, so as to compute the value of the contract. Please note that LIBOR stands for London Interbank Offered Rate. This is the rate on dollar denominated assets. So LIBOR essentially is an interest rate on euro dollar deposits. That is dollar deposits made outside the US. So the rate is still a US dollar rate. Euro yen would be yen denominated deposits outside Japan. Euro euro would be euro denominated assets outside Europe. So on and so forth. The euro dollar deposits have their rate as LIBOR. For the perspective of solving any question, just know this is a dollar rate. The convention is in the LIBOR market is of simple interest, assuming the actual by P60 convention. So if a LIBOR is given, then don't do 1 plus R to the power T. First of all, you will simply do 1 plus R into T. If nothing is mentioned or a general rate is given, you will do 1 plus R to the power T and the year will be 365 days. In the LIBOR market, interest is simply the rate into time, and for calculating this time, the year will be 360 days. So in the numerator will be actual number of days. If it's 41 days, 41 days. If February is 29 days or 28 days, it will actually be 28. But the year will be 360, not 365. We'll do an example and understand. Compute the amount that must be repaid on a $10 million loan for 60 days if the 60-day LIBOR is quoted at 8%. So after 60 days, 10 million will have to be returned with interest. Interest will be the principal into the rate. Rate will always be an annualized number. So we need the 60-day rate, no doubt, because we are doing a borrowing for 60 days. But the rate mentioned is an annualized number. So 0.08 into the time, that will be 60 divided by 360. So this is the total value that will have to be returned at the end of 60 days. Now, just like we have forwards on stocks, bonds that we studied in the previous examples, we can have forwards on interest rates as well. So a forward rate agreement is an agreement to borrow at a pre-decided rate at a pre-decided time in the future. So a 1 into 4 FRA represents a borrowing that will happen 1 month later for a period of 4 minus 1, that is 3 months. If the question mentioned FRA 2 into 5, that means the borrowing would happen 2 months later for a period of 3 months. Similarly, 6 into 8, 8 into 12, whatever I can write. The first M into N, M is how many days later. and n minus m is the period of borrowing. So we'll understand the concept directly with an example. Calculate the price of a 1 into 4 FRA. That is, you want to take a 90 day loan 30 days from now. So you will borrow at t equal to 30 and the loan will extinguish at t equal to 120. We are currently at t equal to 0. The question asked is, what is the rate that the borrower and the lender will agree upon, or what is the no arbitrage rate of interest? The borrower in this transaction probably fears that interest rates will go up in 30 days. Hence, he wants to lock in his borrowing rate. The lender probably fears that the interest rates will go down in 30 days. So he also wants to lock in his lending rate, because if interest rates go down, then he will lose. The question is that what is the rate at which both the borrower and the lender will agree on, given the rates today are so much. So the current 30 day LIBOR is given to be 6%, and the current 120 day LIBOR is given to be 8%. That's the current 120 day rate. Both of them are okay with today's rates. So he wants to lock in today's rate, and so does the lender. Remember, the long counterparty in an FRA is the borrower. The short counterparty is the lender. So if I'm longing a 1 into 4 FRA, that means I'm fixing the rate for a 90 day borrowing 30 days later. If I'm shorting a 1 into 4 FRA, that means I'm fixing the lending rate for a lending happening 30 days later. A lending of 90 days or 3 months happening 30 days later. So the question is, what is this rate 1 into 4? So let's apply the concepts of forward rates that we studied at level 1. So if you are borrowing $100, let's assume for a period of 120 days, then how much will we have to give back at the end of 120 days? 100 into 1 plus the 120 day rate into 120 by 360. If you directly borrowed for 120 days. Instead of borrowing for 120 days, I could borrow my $100 for just 30 days. I will have to pay the 30 day rate multiplied by 30 by 360. The problem with doing this, however, is that 30 days later I have to pay the money back, and I have the money to give only at t equal to 120. So 30 days later, can this entire amount I borrow for another 90 days? The rate applicable then would be the 90 day rate then. That is, I'll have to pay the 90 day rate 30 days from now. Or if I can lock in that rate today, so be it. So let's say R1 into 4 is the 90 day rate 30 days from now. So today itself I can enter into an agreement, because this rate is fixed. So I know 30 days later I'll have to borrow so much. This rate I can fix today, or I can enter into this agreement with the short. And this is the total amount that I'll have to pay at the end of 120 days. This is a straight borrowing. This is a borrowing for 30 days and then borrowing again for 90 days. Please note, rate will be annualized. So into 90 by 360 is what I will have to do. Principle of no arbitrage says that the total amount to be paid must be the same, because this 1 into 4 rate also can be locked in today itself. if this is lower, nobody will borrow like this. The 2-year rate will start going down. If this is higher, nobody will borrow like this. Everybody will borrow directly. This forward rate will start going down, or this rate will going down. At equilibrium, both of these must be the same, otherwise there will be an arbitrage opportunity. So can we compute the 90 day rate 30 days from now? Or we can say R30 is given to us, R120 is given to us. This is R30, this is R120. So we can say 1 plus R1 into 4, that's what we need, the 30 day rate, 30 days, 90 day rate 30 days from now, into 90 by 360 is equal to 1 plus 0.08 into 120 by 360 divided by 1 plus 0.06 into 30 by 360. R1 into 4 into 90 by 360 will be equal to 1.0267 minus 1, or R1 into 4 comes out to be 8.624% approximately. That is, today itself, based on the current rates, I can lock in a 90 day rate 30 days from now as 8.624%. As time passes, as t equal to 30 actually comes, and the 90 day rate at that point in time was, let's assume, 10%, then who has gained, the borrower or the lender? The borrower, because he otherwise would have gotten 10%, but now he has already locked in 8.624%. If actually 30 days later the rate has become 5%, then who has gained? The lender, because otherwise he would have had to lend at 5%. Now he has already locked in his lending at 8.624%. So please verify the calculation. Again, you don't need to remember these formulae. If you understand the logic, you'll be able to solve it in the same manner. Continuing the prior example for a 1 into 4 FRA, assume the notional principal of $10 million and that at contract expiration, the 90 day rate has increased to 9%, which is above the contract rate of 8.62%. Calculate the value of the FRA at maturity, which is equal to the cash payment at settlement. So again, we agreed for 8.62%, that is at t equal to 30, we will borrow, the long will borrow. So here it doesn't mention long or short, so we'll calculate the value for the long, value to the short will be exact opposite. So long means the borrower in an FRA, remember. So we've agreed to borrow at 8.62%. Otherwise, we would have had to borrow at 9%. So at t equal to 120, whether we borrow at 8.62 or 8 or at 9, when do we pay the interest? At t equal to 30 or at t equal to 120? We pay the interest at the end of the period. Otherwise, we would have had to pay 9% on $10 million. Now we only have to pay 8.62%. So this difference is our interest saving, or this is the profit that we have earned. That is, we can borrow this 10 million at 8.62 and simultaneously lend it at 9%, or we can make an additional return of the difference. However, this return will come to us today or at the end. It will come to us at t equal to 120. So we will have to compute the present value of this. For computing the present value, we will discount by today's rate, or we'll discount by 9%. Again, we will use the LIBOR convention understand by 1 plus 0.09 into 90 by 360. Is not even in the numerator, we are not going to get the full 9% and 8.62%. It will have to be multiplied by 90 by 360 because our borrowing is only for one quarter and these are annualized rates. Generally speaking, we can say the value of an FRA and expiration is the notional into the spot rate minus the forward rate into the time divided by 1 plus the spot rate into the time. Again, no need to remember the formula. If you know the concept, you'll be able to solve it easily yourself. So please verify, this will come out to be 9290.95. So for the same FRA that we entered at 8.62%, which was a 1 into 4 FRA, that is a borrowing 30 days later for a period of 90 days. Principal amount $10 million. But we now want to compute the value 10 days after initiation, given that the 20-day LIBOR is now 8.8% and the 110-day LIBOR is 8.9%. So we entered the contract at t equal to 0. The borrowing was scheduled to happen at t equal to 30. The rate of interest was 8.62%. And at t equal to 120 is when we would have returned the interest and the principal. 10 days have passed and now the 20 day rate is given to be 8.8% and the 120 day rate is given to be 8.9%. If we want to exit our derivative, that is, we want to exit our long FRA position, we can now simply short an FRA 20 into 110, that is 20 days later, lend for 90 days. We have already contracted to borrow 20 days later for a period of 90 days. 10 days later, it's no longer a 1 into 4 FRA. It is now a 20 into 110 FRA. So we are longing 20 days later for a period of 90 days at 8.62%. So we will short an offsetting contract, that is short an FRA 20 into 110. So we will lend 20 days later for a period of 90 days. But that lending will now happen at today's rate. So today's rate would be, let's say I was borrowing for 110 days. It would be the 110 day rate today, that is 8.9% into 110 by 360. Instead of that, if I borrowed for 20 days, I would have had to pay 1 plus 8.8 into 20 by 360. And then I would have had to refinance for another 90 days, that is 1 plus X into 90 by 360. X would be the 90 day rate 20 days from now, or we can derive X, that is the current spot or the current 20 into 90 rate at which I will short, as equal to approximately 8.88%. So we have agreed to borrow at 8.62%. We can today itself agree to lend at 8.88%. But please note, whatever these savings would be, we are entering the contract at t equal to 10. But whatever additional interest we will get, will it be at t equal to 30 or t equal to 120? It will be at t equal to 120. So today itself, I can lock in an additional payment of 8.88 minus 8.62 into 90 by 360, because it will still be a 90 day borrowing, divided by 1 plus the current 120 day rate. Please note, I have to discount this value now back to t equal to 10, that is rather the current 110 day rate. So divided by 1 plus 8.9 or 0.089 into 110 by 360 will be the value of the FRA at t equal to 10. That is the value discounted back to t equal to 10. This will come out to be approximately $6,327. Please note, we rounded off at 8.88. So if you go on to more decimal places with $10 million notional, there may be a slight difference in rounding. So never mind about that. The concept still remains the same. And again, no need to remember the formulae. We can solve it the way we do. Now, currency forwards, please recall from the review on economics, or you can watch the introductory video on currency forwards. The forward price is given as the spot price into 1 plus the domestic risk-free rate upon 1 plus the foreign risk-free rate to the power t. If the rates are continuously compounded, then the formula becomes f as s e raised to the power r minus r star into t, where r is the domestic risk-free rate, r star is the foreign risk-free rate. It's the same formula, just assume the foreign rate as the dividend yield, as the continuously compounded dividend yield. The risk-free rates are 5% in the United States and 6% in Japan. The current exchange rate is $0.01 per Japanese yen. Calculate the forward exchange rate for a 140 day or a 160 day forward contract. The forward rate would be the spot rate multiplied by 1 plus the domestic. Please note, bring the currency in direct quote. This is dollar per yen. So the domestic is US and foreign is yen. Please watch the review on economics if you've forgotten all these conventions, direct quote, indirect quote, etc. So 0.01 into domestic is dollar, so 0.05 upon 1 plus 0.06 to the power 1 whole to the power 160 divided by 365. Please verify, the answer comes out to be 0.010053. Now, as time passes, again, even this contract may come in the money or go out of the money. So calculate the value of the forward contract in the previous example. If after 25 days the spot rate is $0.02011 per Japanese yen, so obviously it's an artificially high movement, the currency practically has doubled, which doesn't happen, but still. So once again, at t equal to 0, we entered the contract at t equal to 160. Please note that the long or short will be for the foreign currency. If the quote is in domestic or foreign, if I'm longing, that means I'm longing the Japanese yen. So to begin with, I've entered the contract to long 1 Japanese yen and pay $0.010053. That's the rate that we derived in the previous question. At t equal to 25, I need to short 1 Japanese yen to close out my position. I can short 1 Japanese yen and receive the forward rate today. The forward rate today would be given as the spot rate today into 1 plus the domestic risk-free rate. We'll assume it remains the same, that is 0.05, upon the foreign risk-free rate, that was 6%. So foreign was Japan, domestic was US. To the power 135 divided by 365. The forward rate comes out to be 0.02038. So we will buy the yen for so much, and we'll sell the yen for so much dollar. Both we have locked in today itself. That is at t equal to 25. This is the value at t equal to 160. So we'll discount it back at the rate of, that's the dollar rate that we are have to use because we are in the domestic currency. We will discount it back by 1 plus 0.05 to the power 135 divided by 365. Please verify, the answer will come out to be 0.009808 per yen. That's because we assumed that we are longing one Japanese yen. Had we longed more, the number would have been higher.